All right, my salty little freakoids. Today, tomorrow specifically, we're going to be doing something pretty intense. This is a new one for me and an exciting thing. So, what you see in front of your eyes is not what you think you see in front of your eyes. All right, everybody, this could be either the greatest idea ever and a massive success, or a really stupid plan and a massive failure. But I have found that the best things in life often fit that pattern. What we're going to be doing is something I'm going to call the kip swap, because you didn't make it up. I'll name it after myself. And you can all, and what it, if it's the greatest thing ever, it'll be known as the kip swap. What it is swapping in the 3.2 liter Pentastar in place of the 3.6 liter in a Promaster. Now you might ask yourself, why? In the name of all that is holy, in the name of Minnie Pearl's hat, why would anybody want to put a smaller engine in a Promaster? The opposite should be what you desire. You want a big block. You want a Hemi. You want a turbo. You want all that. The answer is twofold. One has to do with, the primary one has to do with fuel economy. So in my industry, which is expedited freight, it's all about the fuel economy. It's our major expense. It's really our biggest expense, even more so than the price of the vans, if you can believe that. At 100,000 miles a year per van, and with three vans, a point of fuel economy, you know, a tenth of a mile a gallon difference adds up to big bucks. So the smaller engine, all other things being equal, should get better fuel economy. Now, I could stop and talk about EGR and how that replaces normal fuel economy and blah, 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 but it's not really material. The smaller engine, all other things being equal, will get better fuel economy. The other reason for doing the kip swap here has to do with cost. In a minute, I'm going to show you the price difference in buying a used engine and how much cheaper the 3.2 is. It's enough to make the swap worth doing, and it was certainly enough to make the swap worth trying. Because if it works, hey, kip swap. I've written my name in the annals of history. I'm famous. What else is there to know? Here's an important thing to know. I have this written down because I knew you'd ask. So what is the difference between a 3.2 and a 3.6? Well, Chrysler made that block, the Pentastar, what they call the Pentastar, in three different displacements. One is a 3-liter, which is, I believe, China only. I believe it goes into a Jeep in China. At least I've never seen one. And the other is the 3.2. Now, the 3.2 only goes in the Cherokee in this country. It may go into some Fiats or launches in Europe. I couldn't say, but in this country, it only goes in the Cherokee. Not the Grand Cherokee, not the Renegade, the Cherokee, the squinty one. The important thing to know is that, surprisingly, the power outputs and the figures are not that different from the two engines. Let's take a look, shall we? Let the numbers be our guide. All right, let's look at horsepower first. The 3.2 has 271 horsepower at 6,750 RPM. The 3.6 liter, the one we have, the stock one, has 283 horsepower at 6,400 RPM, a difference of 12 horsepower. Now, 12, albeit the smaller engine does make it 350 RPM higher. But I don't think 12 horsepower is going to be enough to make a difference, and certainly not enough a difference to worry about. 12 horsepower is immaterial. I mean, to this application, 6,700 RPM is immaterial. Okay, but here's the real figure, because this is what really counts, is the torque, right? So the 3.2, the smaller engine, makes 239 foot-pounds at 4,400 RPM. The bigger engine, the one we have now, makes 260 foot-pounds at 4,800 RPM, a difference of 21 foot-pounds. Now, 21 foot-pounds, that's chunky. I mean, that's some tug, you'd notice it. But you'll notice that the smaller engine makes it 400 RPM lower, and conversely, the bigger engine makes it 400 RPM higher, and both of those are well over 4,000 RPM, 4,400, 4,800. My feeling is that I'm personally not interested in any of the torque the engine makes over 3,000 RPM, because in my application, we don't go over 3,000 RPM. Cruise at 60 miles an hour is 2,000 RPM, and anything else is, I don't really care. What I care about is how much torque does it make at cruise, and I would hazard a guess that for engines that are only 21 foot-pounds apart at 4,400 RPM, I bet there are only, you know, well less than 10 foot-pounds apart at 2,000 or 2,500 where I need to be. Granted, if you were smart, you'd have a dyno plot or have done more research, but I'm not that guy. All right, let's move on to the cost. That's very important. Money is really what it's all about. All right, this is how one goes about selecting an engine. You go here. This is high tech, isn't it? Carpart.com. Carpart is a search engine for junkyards. You fill out this form here, which is Ram Promaster 3500. Doesn't really matter, as you know. Select part. You'll find them all. I'm going to put engine. This is fun to work double-handed. I'm going to sort them by distance from my location. That's my location is 44203. And we're going to search. It asks me if I want diesel or gas. I'd say gas. Okay, these are Promaster engines. And as you can see, they're sorted by distance. They start at a place called Black River, a junkyard I've been to 35 miles from me. This is distance. This is the name, the call, the price, the miles, the blah, 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 and a few notes. This top one happens to say 3.6 gas, VIN letter G, and the eighth digit, 3.6, some broken parts from accident, loose on pallet. If you were to click on this, it'll show you a fairly standardized group of pictures. Dude appears to have hit something and popped his bags and so on, so you get an idea of what's going on there. The important part is the number and the name, and that's from a 15, the next one's a 17, and so on. If you look, let's say I wanted to limit myself to around 100,000 miles. I keep going down until I find the engine I want. Here's 60,000 miles for $3,000. Here's 101 for $2,800. And they go on and on. You'll find that there is a national junkyard chain called LKQ, which is basically the standard by which all these others are judged. You also notice that there's only 5 total pages of Promaster engines. Let's see. In your particular case, if you're looking for a Promaster engine, what you'll do is you'll go back here. But instead of looking for a 14 Promaster, you'll look for a Dodge Journey. Dodge Journey, USA, from my distance, sort by distance. Again, 3.6, eighth digit is G in the VIN. Okay, notice the difference. Here are 99,000 mile engines at $2,200. So that's $800 off. And these are all LKQ, which is near me in Akron. There's a branch. You'll notice that there's 30 to 40 LKQ engines from over here. It shows you what it's from: a 14 Town and Country, a 14 Caravan, a 15 TNC, a 17 Journey, a 15 Journey, and so on. You'll find Journey, Caravan, and Town and Country over here, and some VW Routon. I don't know if they made it that late. Regardless, doesn't matter. So LKQ tiers their engines. 100 and up, 100,000 miles and up is $2,090. Under 100,000 miles, see if I can find one here that's under 100 from a Journey or whatever. Oh, this is Bessler, are they up here? Okay, 99,000, $2,295. So they're basically adding $205 for under. And there's another tier under that where it's more expensive. I can find a very low miles one from LKQ, and I have to sift through. You'll also notice that because we're looking at Journey, instead of 5 pages, there's now 71 pages of junkyards in the country that are listing these engines. And of course, they're stored by distance from me, okay? Now, so that's the number to keep in your mind, around $2,000 for a 100,000 mile engine. You could pay more for a newer, lower miles one. And Journey engines through 2018, 14 to 18 will fit. And 11 to 13 will probably fit with a few modifications, but I've never done it, so I don't want to promise it to you. But here's the important thing, what we're going to be talking about in this video, which will be, of course, long and very annoying. If we go to Jeep, Jeep Cherokee, except Grand Cherokee. I'm looking at a 15. I want an engine sorted by distance from my location. Note that there are two engines available with the Journey, a 3.2 with a one-piece oil pan, a two-piece oil pan, and then two four-bangers. I'm not interested in either of those. If I look for the two-piece oil pan, which is basically identical in the oil pan section, you'll find, how many do we find? We find 13 pages of them, and they are, here's one for 1,700 with 71,000 miles. Well, you can read. 900, so on, blah, 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 blah. $750 for an engine with 82,000 miles on it. And do I have a direct comparison with an LKQ yard? That would be interesting to know what LKQ gets and the price difference in their tiers. But I'm not seeing any. Oh, there's one.
LKQ in Martinsburg, West Virginia, has a 128,000-mile engine for $750. That tells you something, because that same engine in Journey would be $2,090. That's a lot cheaper, but there's a better way, because we're always looking for the better way. The one-piece oil pan is the one you don't want, but look at the prices, kids. $790 for 72,000 miles. $600. $481 for a 142K. And I can even... $480 for a high mileage engine. I mean, come on, $480. I spent more than that on a lap dance. Here's the ones I bought. I went to 422 Auto Sales, which is 40 miles from me in Warren. And I looked at both of these engines, and I picked this upper one with 93,000 miles for $500. That engine that you saw in the van over here was $500. Now, at that price, I feel like I could experiment with putting a 3.2 in place of a 3.6. All right. Can't have more fun than that. All right, I'll pull it in. All right, early initial differences between this 3.2 and a normal 3.6. I see the airbox is different here, but everything else is the same, including the intake. I see...
All right, this is where we go back to voiceover, because that guy just stuck talking and talking. After much research so far, we've been able, at least I've been able to determine two differences between the 3.2 and the 3.6, and they are pretty minor. One is obviously the displacement, but that is made by simply a different bore size. The stroke is the same, and every other part is the same, but the bore size is smaller in a 3.2. Theoretically, it should make the engine more rigid if the bore size is smaller, everything else being equal, but whatever. And the other difference is that the 3.2 has higher compression. The 3.2 has 10.7:1 compression, and the 3.6 has, I believe it's 10.1 or 10.2, something like that. Pretty high compression, so I'm kind of worried. But maybe I shouldn't be, because they're basically identical. They only, you know, the bore size and the compression. What I'm counting on is that the engine computer, which is the same physical computer, will be able to trim the fuel such a way that it'll compensate for the engine being smaller. It won't know or care that the engine's smaller. It will just think it's doing what it's doing, and the computer strives to make the engine run at a certain air-fuel ratio that it keeps constant. That's its most efficient, you know, best compromise of power and fuel economy and heat generation and stress on parts. It's 14.6:1 air to parts of fuel. I'm betting that the computer, even though the engine will be taking in less air, 0.4 liters less of air, the computer will just put in less fuel to compensate, and it will trim the fuel curves and the spark maps to compensate for that missing displacement. Because it doesn't really know. It's just a dumb computer, and it can be fooled. And, you know, there are a lot of things in life where if they didn't tell you, you wouldn't know, and this would be a good example of the same.
All right, children, boys and girls. We're going to be undressing the 3.2 for the kip swap. My narcissism kicks in. That will entail removing a bunch of stuff to get at the front cover, replacing it with a 3.6 front cover. It will entail, to get the front cover off, we'll have to pull the cam phasers and valve covers, which is a good time to inspect the valve train while we're in there. As you can see, the front seal is out for the crank seal. That did not require a puller. I thought that was odd. It just came right off. Which is fine. It's on a keyed, or it must be internally keyed. I don't know how it's keyed. For the balancer, there will be, to get the valve covers off, we're going to take the intake tract off anyway, because it turns out the cooler has bad seals, and we're here. It's a good time to break all that stuff loose, and Annie sees it, because I'm into these engines constantly. Not constantly, but more often than the average bear. Additionally, this one-piece oil pan will come off, and that two-piece oil pan will go on, meaning 3.2 engine with a 3.6 oil pan. Unless you buy the one that's one-piece, that would probably work. We're going to find out. If not, this was just an expensive experiment. Oh, boy. There it goes. You just got to want it. It's very ASMR. deeply satisfied. Okay, that is amazing. Look at the inside of that cover. Yeah, which one's old and which one's new?
New, old.
It's like two different Iron Man suits. I can see the differences in the casting. That's a different backing piece.
Yep.
Everything else, this channel here is a little bit different than it is on here. Could you see if I put this in here the right way? See what's left of that bolt? That is the cylinder wall. And I can see it better than you can, but man, it is beautiful. And why wouldn't it be? This is a modern engine. Things like ring ridge and...
Ooh, that crosshatch does look
the crosshatch
nice.
Is perfect.
Yeah, it looks pretty fucking nice.
Yeah.
That's what it's supposed to look like.
It looks like it was the day it was born. Mm-hmm. All right, so what's happening here is about to put this front dress back on in the lower pan with it. Well, it's a nice size bead.
Of the marriage.
I was not waiting for this moment.
Of the 3.2 liter. What'd you say?
All right. Okay, moment of truth. So it's in, and it's in enough to start, we think. I've scanned the whole system here, and everything's reading nominal with no codes. Which makes sense because the battery's been disconnected, and I am about to tell Lincoln to go ahead and crank it. Do you want to pull the fuel relay, or do you want to just let it, just multi-crank it? All right, moment of truth, kids. This is exciting. Turn the headlights off while you're in there. It says we've got 12.2 volts. HVAC door is actuating, as you may have seen. I'm born ready.
Holy shit.
It's pissing out the transmission fluid, so we gotta keep... Hey, Lincoln, the bucket's... No, the bucket's right over there. I'd take 10 more seconds.
Okay. She runs. She fucking runs.
That's ridiculous. It feels like it's got a cough off idle, but...
Yeah, that's running, though.
That is running.
Sound bad.
Shut her down.
Okay.
It's amazing. All right, I'm going to do some digging in the computer here.
I don't want to blow it up, but...
short-term. Relax, shield things are weird. But short-terms are dead nuts, and everything else is dead nuts. Engine temp.
What is long-term?
What is long-term? It's fluctuating between 19% and like 2%. But the short-terms are staying in single digits, and they're swinging to positive and negative.
Cherokee? Shark Jeep.
Squinty Cherokee? Indeed, there she goes.
There she goes.
I didn't think that would work. Do you think that would work?
I had serious, serious doubts. I also have serious doubts about its living longevity-wise, but I mean, it's an experiment.
Yeah.
Well, I think by any and all definitions of success, that was a complete success. Basically code-free, seems to be running fine. This video was shot a few days later, I just happened to be following the van. I don't have any data yet, hard data, on fuel economy, but we're going to put this van back in service and run it 10,000 miles a month and see what it turns. From the seat of the pants, I'm guessing it's going to be as good or better fuel economy. So then in the final analysis, all we did is for $500, we sliced 400,000 miles off the odometer. That's an excellent thing. Also like to mention the shop, ProMasters only, is going to be open here in the next few weeks. Thinking about taking limited appointments. We already have quite a few appointments already. And trying to kind of get into it slow because I'm worried about being overwhelmed. And I hope you've enjoyed this ridiculous video. I've learned a lot. I don't doubt you've learned anything, but somebody's got to learn something. But you come see me and have some bad coffee and we'll touch each other and they'll be rubbing. And I will lay my hands upon your van. Take care, kids. I love you all. Carry on.